Hello and welcome to the Calculator Guy video on exam board advice, how to use your calculator. We're going to be taking a look at this document produced by AQA, A-Level Maths, the thinking behind great assessment. I'm going to put a link in the description below so that you can go and have a look at a copy for yourselves. But we're going to focus on a specific page in the document, how we assess calculator use. So this is going to look at how AQA assesses your calculator use in the A-Level Maths examination. So let's take a look. Using calculators in exams is more important than it was in the old modular specification, and we really embrace this development. When the specification was being developed and the specimen papers written, the capabilities of what has rapidly become the standard calculator for AS and A-Level Maths were not well known to us because this calculator wasn't widely available. So they may in fact be referring to the Casio Classwiz FX991EX, and so that wasn't perhaps first available, or at least very popular in the UK when the first exam papers were being written. Similar story with the FX CG50. So they continue in developing the recent published practice paper set 1 and writing live exam papers. We are now very conscious of what the standard calculator can do. Now, this is a very positive news from AQA. They're really embracing using your calculator and many of the functions that are available on the calculator to the fullest extent in the A-Level Maths exam. And I imagine that it allows more time to consider your methods and your mathematical thinking during the exam and not get too bogged down with the calculations, because you can let your calculator do some of that work for you. Let's take a look at the list of what they expect students to be able to do with their calculator. Let's have a look at the first two from the list here. Solve quadratic equations and find the coordinates of a vertex of a quadratic function. Well, this is using the polynomial solver on the Classwiz. So let's just take a look. From the menu, it is equation function, 2 for polynomial, and then degree of polynomial, it's going to be degree 2. A quadratic has the highest degree of x squared, so it's degree 2. Let's use this to solve this equation, x squared plus 2x minus 35 equals 0. We've got an x squared coefficient of 1 plus 2x minus 35. And if we press equals, here we've got the first solution to this quadratic equation. So our first solution is x equals 5. And press equals again, we've got the second solution here, x equals minus 7. So the exam board expects you to be able to use this solver to be able to solve quadratic equations. You are in a situation where you need to solve a quadratic equation in your exam. You don't necessarily have to use the quadratic formula or factorize to solve, etc. You can use the polynomial solver to help you. And as I mentioned, factorize, there is a method that you can use the solutions to then put a quadratic equation into the factorized form if you're asked to do that. A technique known as solve then factorize. There is 5 activities on this from the calculator guide. The first of these activities is free, and I'll put a link in the description if you want to go and download and take a look at that. 5 exercises in total to get you up to date on that technique. Additionally, if we press equals again, then what we will find is we'll have the x coordinate of the vertex of this quadratic function. So here it's even stated the nature of the vertex and the nature of the turning point there. It's a minimum with an x coordinate of minus 1. And if you press equals again, we'll get the y coordinate of negative 36. So it's told us the minimum point, the turning point. If we had negative x squared, it would say max on there because the vertex would be a maximum. So straight away we can go to the minimum point, the vertex of this quadratic function. There's no need to complete the square, and incidentally, these results here from the calculator can help you to complete the square if you're asked to do that at some point, but we can use this particular feature to find that vertex more quickly. Let's move on down the list. So the next two are solve quadratic inequalities and solve simultaneous linear equations in 2 variables. Let's take a look at the first one, solve quadratic inequalities. If we return to menu and then we navigate to the next mode along, so inequality. Once again, polynomial degree, it's degree 2 if it's a quadratic. And then we've got 4 different options here based on the inequality type that we have. Let's take a look at this one. Solve x squared minus 7x minus 8 is greater than or equal to 0. If we match that to the choices that we have on screen, that's option 3 here. So let's select that and let's input the coefficients that we have. 1x squared minus 7x minus 8. If we press equals to confirm, then it will tell us the range of values that satisfy that inequality. So x is less than or equal to minus 1, x is greater than or equal to 8. And then the second part here, solve simultaneous linear equations in two variables. Let's go back to menu, and this is going to be in equation function again, and it's the top option here. Simultaneous equation, let's select one. Number of unknowns, well, two variables, so therefore we've got two unknowns. And I won't go through an example here, but you can input the number of x's, the number of y's, and what they equal, and that will be able to solve that for you. So if you get in a situation where you've got two linear simultaneous equations, you won't need to do a method by elimination, etc. You can just use the simultaneous equation solver to help you out with that one. Okay, so next on the menu would be calculate summary statistics for a frequency distribution. While I was working with the calculator, I did accidentally forget this one, so we're going to return to it just a little bit later. Just bear that in mind. We're going to move on to find the scalar product of two vectors. Find the angle between two vectors. So the calculator guide at this particular point in time doesn't have any videos on using the vector mode, but it's certainly the aim to do some more of those in the future. This is perhaps more specifically targeted at further maths students, which need to use the vector mode more heavily. You can still use it in regular A-level maths, but it's needed a little bit less. But there is the vector mode available on the ClassWiz FX991EX. If you go and have a look, you've just got the option here to define your vectors. You input your vectors, whether it's a 2D vector or a 3D vector, it can cope with both. So you've got four different vectors that you can input there and do various calculations with them. So hopefully more videos on those going forward. Let's move to the next one here. Repeat an iterative process, including the Newton-Raphson method. This is primarily using the ANTS feature on the calculator. That's been around a short while. So just using the ANTS back in an iteration formula and repeatedly refining your solution to get closer to the actual value. So they're just acknowledging here that they want you to use your calculator to do that. Okay, moving on down the list. So find binomial and normal probabilities and find the Z value for a normal distribution. So quite a number of videos available for this on the calculator guide and elsewhere. So there's quite a number of videos that have been produced on this that are available for you to have a look at how to do those. And it's also going to be a feature of the forthcoming course that we have here at the calculator guide, Master Your Casio ClassWiz Statistics, Distributions and Probability, designed for the FX991EX and the 570EX models. Just putting the finishing touches on that, so it's going to be ready very soon. It is going to be a premium course based on some of the YouTube videos and lots of extras and some worksheets too. So if you're interested in doing a deep dive on how to use statistics, distribution and probability on your FX991EX, then just look out for that course. It's going to be releasing soon. Back to the list, and let's just return to the one that I forgot originally, which is calculate summary statistics for a frequency distribution. This has been made really very straightforward compared to previous generations of calculator. And once again, there are many videos that I've already produced on using the summary statistics. Go into statistics mode, input your table of data, your frequency distribution into there. You can add a frequency column. You can have more than one variable, so you can look at regression too. And they've done a summary statistics page, which makes it very easy to pick out the various statistics that you need to answer your question. So let's just go to the bottom two on here. Calculate a definite integral and calculate the derivative of a function at a given point. Once again, the calculator guide has produced previous videos regarding using the definite integrator and the derivative function, which are available for you to use. So go back and check out those videos. There's also an already published course on this available at the Calculator Guide School and various other platforms. Master Your Casio ClassWiz Calculus, Trigonometry and Logarithms. Again, a premium course, but if you want to deep dive into that, then that is available for you to do that. There'll be a link in the description below. But what's important is that the exam boards have acknowledged that the calculator has these features and you are allowed to use them in your A-level exam. So let's continue with the document. We recognize that a calculator can solve any equation using a numerical method, but we tend to set questions that make this feature inappropriate. So this is essentially an allusion to the solve feature, which is on the Casio ClassWiz. And what they're suggesting is they might put some method involving algebra or algebra manipulation into the question so that it's not just as straightforward as inputting something into the calculator. You have to work with non-calculator methods in order to be able to solve a particular function. So that's just what they're saying here. That doesn't mean you can't necessarily use your calculator. It just means that you're not going to be able to just input it into the calculator and solve it to get an answer straight away. So it's just about testing different methods of thinking. The exam is there to stretch your thinking and to assess how well you can think mathematically, and this is just them recognizing that. Let's continue with the last paragraph. When not to use a calculator. However, we will be looking to include parameters in questions so that they cannot be done on a calculator, so that we test students' abilities to carry out particular techniques. Look out for the instructions show that or questions that ask students to find the exact value of, with the additional instruction to fully justify your answer. This means we require a non-calculator method with all steps clearly shown. So what they're really saying there is they're not saying, well, you know, you need to put your calculator to one side and you can't use it. They're just saying that each step of your method that you're doing as you're going through that question, you need to show your mathematical thinking. You need to show exactly what you're doing. You can't just rely on putting some figures into the calculator to show that. Now, there's two further videos on looking at this exam advice to just show this a little bit more clearly. The first video, I go through two very calculator-driven questions in which you are perfectly entitled to use all the modes and functions of your calculator. In fact, it's expected to be able to get the answer really quickly and effectively. The other video, what I'll be looking at, is a fully justified question where we can actually obtain the answer to the question about halfway through using the calculator, but that isn't going to be sufficient to get you the marks. You need to fully show your working and how you're getting it. The calculator tends to perform more of a support role to support you with any arithmetic, etc., when you're doing that. But the method you must show on the paper must be a non-calculator based method. So that will be the fully justified question. Just going back to where it says the exact value of, that will mean writing an answer perhaps in terms of pi, a fraction, a third, maybe in terms of e or logarithms. It doesn't mean giving a decimal result from your calculator. So that's another way that they can get you to do a non-calculator method, is your calculator might just produce a decimal approximation. That isn't going to be good enough to get you the mark, so you need to use a non-calculator method to work it through and get this exact answer. You can certainly use a decimal equivalent to check as a verification for that, but it's not going to be good enough to get you the marks just to put the decimal equivalent of an exact value. So there we go, excellent advice that's made it a lot clearer on when and where we can use the calculator within the exam. So don't forget to take a look at those other two videos going into how to use your calculator more fully, and also what it means when it's a fully justified answer that is required, where and when you can use your calculator on that. Don't forget to subscribe for future videos, but thank you very much for watching, and I will see you next time on The Calculator Guide.